Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.
My friends and I always tune into the Todd Levitt Law Show. Todd is entertaining, informative, and always delivers the goods.
Todd might not tell you what you want to hear, but he's going to tell you what you need to hear. And all you got to do is listen.
Hold on, Todd. Don't let go. It's time for the Todd L. Levitt Law Show.
Welcome to the Todd L. Levitt Marijuana Law Podcast. Good morning, good evening, and good night. I'm yours truly, attorney Todd L. Levitt, broadcasting and podcasting in the middle of Mitten, a beautiful frozen nutrient field under the ice. It's always nice with my good friend in the mothership, the Black Diamond Group mothership, Craig Russell, the muscle, the hustle. How you doing, Craig?
I'm cold, Todd. It's been downright chilly this week. I'm not going to lie to you. It's been cold.
It has been cold, and which has no relevance to why we opened up the show today with level 42 from, as you told me, 1985.
That's right. Something about you. Great, great, great 80s pop song. Fantastic.
Just awesome. But yeah, it has been just chilled out there. And obviously, we've brought the fatties out. The fat bikes are out. So
I was going to wonder, when do you put the bikes away, and when do you start snowboarding, or when do you put the chains on the bikes? What do you do? All the ski resorts are all getting ready to open up. There's been so much snow up north. It isn't even funny. They're all ready to go.
So the Iceman that we talked about over the last 2 weeks is the last race of the race season.
Okay.
And we put our, you know, gravel bikes, and in my case, my carbon fiber salsa away, and bring out the fatty. Right now, I'm shredding the gnar with a Trek Farley fatty, 3.5-inch tires, studded. That Farley's made in Wisconsin, by the way. So big shout out to Trek Bikes in Wisconsin, American-made company. We love all American-made products. And then I have another fatty with 5-inch tires by Traeger.
If I didn't know you were talking about a bike, I was going to say, fatty? Oh no, I'm kidding.
Fatty,
joke.
But
joking.
Again, when nice. That's the theme of the show, right?
Yeah,
I always wear my 45 North products. There's a company out of Minnesota called 45 North, like the number 45 North.
Sure.
Great company. You can purchase all their products at bike stores and online at 45north.com. And I just love their products, and they keep us nice and toasty when we're shredding out there. But hey, Craig, how you doing today? We have a huge, this show is going to be unbelievable.
Big show. This would be what we would normally call, this is a special presentation of the Todd L. Levitt Law Show and Marijuana Law Podcast. Why? Because it's all about the hemp today. About the hemp. You curious?
It is.
You curious about the hemp, Todd?
I'm always curious about the hemp, the seed, how you grow it, how you get it, how it's produced, how it goes to market. What's the best soil to grow it in? How do you grow it? What kind of farm equipment?
What do you use it for? What do you use it for?
Yeah, exactly.
What do you do with it?
How the laws are currently affecting growers on the state level versus the federal level. And Matt Hatala is in the mothership.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to be talking to Matt coming up in all the rest of the segments of the show about all things hemp. And Matt's a Marine, served our country, and we love and appreciate him for that, as we do all of our veterans and those serving. But yeah, I'm excited to talk to Matt about everything hemp, farming and beyond.
And oddly enough, he's from a little town in Iowa that I used to live in when I worked in Iowa. I worked for a couple of years at a radio station in Waterloo, Iowa, and lived in a little town just north of it called Waverly. And I found out in talking to him, that's where he grew up. It was crazy. Totally small world. Totally.
Great guy. I mean, just a great, great guy. Honorable, just great guy, and so knowledgeable in everything hemp. So I'm really excited to have him and appreciate him taking the time out to be with us today.
I'm going to dub him the hemp guru. He is our hemp guru. He is our go-to hemp guy. You know how we got Leto, who's our go-to guy when it comes to like historical things or lemon laws and car stuff like that? This is going to be our go-to hemp guy. Our hemp guru.
What's big here? What's big here, our go-to guy?
He is our Prius and plaid guru and yoga pants.
And by the way, if you're just tuning in for the first time, big here, my best friend and a member of the mountain bike team.
Oh, yeah,
He does like yoga. He does spin classes. And he's notorious for cutting his neighbor's lawns. This year, he blew the leaves off his neighbor's lawn without her permission. So that's a whole nother story for future shows. But Craig,
but Todd,
I'm fresh off my appearance at Mikey's Pizza in Whittemore, where I beckoned back to my old days as a waiter and a delivery guy.
How'd that go?
Well, I got written up 4 times.
For what?
4
what'd
times.
You get, what'd you get written up for?
Jen wrote me up twice because I didn't answer the phones fast enough. I took an order for a Meat Lover's Pizza, and they added a side of fried pickles, and I forgot to bring out the pickles.
Oh.
So I got to out myself there. So my complaint is with myself, but it was such a cool place. Mikey's Pizza, I so appreciate him allowing us the opportunity to do this from open to close. His workers are terrific. The pizza, the breadsticks. And some great people came out. Rowan and family came out. Big shout out to Rowan and family. Just outstanding family. Mayor Clark from Omer. So my good friend, dear friend, he's actually a personal friend of mine, Clark, and his wife Ginger came out. He's the mayor of Omer, Michigan.
Okay.
So many nice people. And major love goes out to all those I just mentioned. And our good friends at J&J Seeds, Charlie Chevalier, the coolest dude in the world. Charlie and his wife, Sue, came out to say hi, and they brought me a hoodie, a new J&J hoodie. It's just a great hoodie. I've worn it twice already. So big shout out to Chevalier. That's a great name.
That is a great name. It's French, isn't it?
Yeah. Our good friends at J&J Seeds does a great job. So we're going to be talking a little bit about J&J down the road.
Yeah, and especially with Matt.
Hemp,
that's exactly right. It all kind of ties in together. Isn't it odd how it all works out like that sometimes?
It's such a small world, but great time at Mikey's Pizza, and met so many nice people out there. It was just so cool.
Well, I'm glad you had a good time, and I'm glad you didn't screw up too badly. And
I told you I got written up 4 times.
Well,
too much
4
cheese
times.
On one pizza, not enough pepperoni on the next one, a little bit more ham. I don't know.
So did you end up getting your tips docked for that, or did you?
No, I didn't take any tips.
Oh, okay.
We didn't even make it. You know, we just did this for the love of it. That's all.
Well, that's
help Mikey out and meet all the people out there. We're going to do it again down the road. So
what is Mikey's specialty? I've never been to Mikey's before. You know, what's their pizza specialty?
Just the pizza, the dough, the cheese, the homemade sauce. It's just, it's all, the crust is thick and juicy, and it fills you up in the breadsticks. They got all kinds of great food there.
Man, it is too early in the morning for me to be hungry for pizza. Come on, man. What are you doing? What are you doing?
What's up with that? Hey, we have a huge show for the listeners, though, Craig, our good friend coming up in the show. We're going to be talking with Matt Hatala. We're going to be talking about everything hemp.
Yes, it is the hemp episode. So when you see this, when you maybe if you listen to this on the radio and you go check out the podcast somewhere at any one of the 10,000 platforms we podcast on. This will be in parentheses, the Hemp Show, because it's all going to be all about the hemp. We're going to find out how to make it, how to grow it, how to cultivate it, how to get it to market, how to make money with it, how what the problems with people trying to make money with it these days, and what you use it for. Yeah. What do you use it for?
I mean, you can use it for just about everything and anything. Okay. Hey, also, big shout out to all the hunters out there.
Oh, that's right.
Who are in their blinds out there. Just enjoying opening weekend in the state of Michigan, rifle season. So I have a lot of friends and family out there in their deer blinds, probably listening to the show. They probably should turn it down or put their earbuds on so they don't spook the deer out there. But good luck, everybody out there.
Yeah, for people who are not in Michigan, November 15th is the start of firearm deer
holiday.
Season.
It's a holiday.
It is a holiday. I didn't know until I moved up north, never knew how big of a deal it was. All of a sudden, people, you know, schools are closed, businesses are closed, and I'm like, what's going on? It's the first day of firearm deer season. Now, you know, not everywhere in this country do they have hunting. Some places do, and most places do, I would say, especially the northern two-thirds of the country. But in Michigan, it is a special rite of passage. This is a big deal. You go anywhere north of, say, maybe a line probably from Midland to Mount Pleasant to Big Rapids, anywhere north, and it literally is a holiday. They close the schools because like 3/4 of the kids don't even show up.
I love venison. Yeah, I love jerky, venison, all that stuff.
I've never been a fan. It's always been too deery tasting.
I'll send you some. Big Hair makes some great venison jerky. We'll have to send it your way.
All right. Anything Big Hair makes, I have a feeling, is going to be good. So. Yeah.
Hey, again, big shout out to
Charlie Chevalier
and family at J&J.
You just like saying that name, don't you?
He's a cool guy too. Great guy, great family. Hey, Craig, we have to go to break, don't we?
We do, but when we come back, Matt Hatala will be on to talk about everything hemp, our hemp guru. He will be coming up in the mothership on the Tata Levitt Law Show. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show, broadcasting and podcasting in the Black Diamond Group Mothership. Big shout out, by the way, this week to all of our listeners that download the show in Australia, Sweden, France, Spain, UK, Germany, and Ireland. They led the way in the downloads across planet Earth this past week, Craig.
Well, I have to say a special shout out to everyone who is in Australia. They are dealing with catastrophic wildfires in Australia. Some places in New South Wales, they call it a county, but it's actually way bigger than that. It's near Sydney in that area. There's wildfires. It makes the wildfires that we've had in California in this country look like a small brush fire compared to what they've got going on there. It's burning millions and millions of acres. So everyone in that part of the country, in that part of the world, please be safe. Enjoy the podcast. But if you can't enjoy it, we understand why, because it's a big deal.
Yeah, absolutely. Craig, let's bring Matt on.
That sounds like a good idea. Nobody wants to hear us ramble on about stuff. Our hemp guru is Matt Hatala. Hey, Matt. Hey, how you doing, Matt?
good, you guys. I appreciate you having me on, Craig. Hemp guru, that's absolutely flattering. But I would just like to say I by no means consider myself an expert in the hemp industry. I just have been in the trenches a little longer than some people and, you know, have learned a few things along the way. So I'm glad to be here and hopefully I can share a few of those experiences with you guys and your audience today and help them out if they have any questions.
Well, Matt, here's the deal, though. If we don't know something about hemp and we ask you and you know something about it, you know what that makes you? Our hemp guru. That's what it makes you.
That's that's A-okay. I just don't want to give anyone the impression that you know, I'm by any means an expert. I think there's a lot of people right now still trying to wrap their head around this crop and understand it. So for anybody to call themselves an expert might be a little too forthcoming at this point. So, but I do think it's flattering. I appreciate it. Hopefully I can answer all those questions you guys throw my way.
Yeah, and Craig, we said it at the outcast of the show. And you mentioned it. You lived in a town in which Matt was born and raised. And I believe after high school, Matt, is that when you entered the Marines right after high school?
Yes. Yeah, so actually, Craig and I lived in Waverly same time. I was still in high school when Craig would live there. And then I graduated in 2007 and left almost immediately after that for California, where I did my boot camp and then was stationed out there for 4 years.
And that's crazy. And it's crazy that we knew that I knew where you were from. You're like, we were talking about this a couple of days ago off the air, and I said, so where are you from in Iowa? He goes, a little town north of Waterloo and Cedar Falls called Waverly. I'm like, get out of here, because I worked at a radio station in Waterloo for 2 years, from 2004 to 2006, and my ex and kids at the time lived in Iowa. My son was actually born at the Waverly Medical Center in Iowa in 2005. You would have been a junior in high school, Matt. Is that correct?
That is correct.
That's crazy.
And actually, my son was born in the same hospital.
Wow.
So,
all right, everybody.
Yeah, real small world.
It's a small world after all. Everybody, it's a small world. Okay, now I'm sorry.
But yeah, actually, I'm going to be moving back there to that area here shortly to get ready for next year and helping Iowa farmers get them ready as well for hemp and everything that's going to come along with it in 2020 for our state.
Again, we appreciate your service and can't thank you enough, first and foremost, and family sacrifice and everything that comes along with service. For our listeners out there who don't know anything about hemp, cannabis, can you start off with the basics? I mean, what's the difference between growing the hemp stalk or plant compared to the marijuana THC version of the plant?
So right now, by federal definition, the difference there will be the THC content. Both plants are cannabis sativa, but the differentiating factor is the fact that hemp plants, or by definition hemp plants, have less than 0.3% THC. So anything above that threshold is considered cannabis, or medical cannabis, depending on where you're located at. And that's a big differing factor. A lot of people think that these are, cousin plants or, two different species. It's really not. It's the same plant. It's cannabis sativa, but hemp was bred for different characteristics that incorporate, staying below that 0.3% THC level, where cannabis, marijuana doesn't have to abide by those standards, obviously.
My question is, in relation to that, where are we at now on a federal level? We've talked about this, about the 2014 Farm Bill, and then the 2018 Farm Bill, I believe, that was signed in December of 2018. Where are we at federally with everything?
The proposed rules by the USDA was actually just signed off of at the White House about a week and a half or 2 weeks ago. Don't quote me on that. It's somewhere around there. So that basically puts into effect all the rules that the USDA has been working on over the past several months since the signing of the Farm Bill. And that gives, from what I understand, states a deadline to have their plan for industrial hemp in their state submitted by December 1st. So once those plans are submitted by each state, they will go through an approval process with the USDA. And once they're approved, they will be put into place. And I believe the turnaround period is that the USDA has 30 days in which to approve or disprove those plans. So I would say tentatively around January 1st, a lot of licenses should begin to open up on the state level once their plans have been approved by the USDA, if they submit them, right away on December 1st or close to.
In the state of Michigan, farmers have been allowed to apply for licensing through the state capitol online and grow hemp. Is that being done, and has that been done under the old farm bill?
Yes. So everything that was grown this year was actually grown under the 2014 Farm Bill. Michigan had voted to have a pilot program, but had never put into place formal rules or structure for that program since 2014. So it sat there in limbo. And one of the things that we had done earlier in the spring was have meetings with MDART, have seminars where we invited MDART out, meet with the farmers. Because at that time, they still hadn't decided if they were going to allow it for 2018. It came right down to the wire this year. I think it was April. MDARD finally said, okay, we're going to allow cultivation of industrial hemp under the 2014 Farm Bill for this year. So it was a real mad dash to get to the starting line this year. But yes, everything that was grown in Michigan was under the Farm Bill, which required each of the farms to submit a research plan that was supposed to be designed to help the state of Michigan get as much data as possible on the plant and the different possibilities that this new commodity is going to have for the state.
So let's back up a second. What is MDARD? Is that what you were calling it? What is that an acronym for?
Yeah, in Michigan, that's the Michigan Department of Agriculture and Rural Development.
Okay.
So it's their state agricultural office.
Okay.
They're the ones that put in place the rules, and they're the ones overseeing the hemp industry in Michigan currently.
Now, my question is, you're talking about having licenses and having things being regulated. It almost sounds like marijuana production and the whole marijuana thing. You have to have a license, you have to apply for it, et cetera, et cetera. Is that what the plan is someday? Do you think that the way hemp is going to be regulated is eventually the way most, if not all, the states and or federally, the way marijuana is going to be regulated or is?
I sure hope not. I mean, I've seen what Laura and the MMFLA here in Michigan, what that process has been like for people. And I really hope not, because, this year for us, it was $1,000 for a processor license and I think $350 for a grower license. You compare that to some of the prices you're seeing on a 1,000 or 1,500 plant grow in the marijuana industry. And it's astronomically
it's insane.
Yeah, different. So I really hope not. I mean, I hope that the opposite happens and they start to see some of these regulations that they're trying to impose, like the new federal regulation on 0.3% THC. That's such a subjective number. That number was made by bureaucrats without any understanding of the plant. You could go up to 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, and that plant is not going to be psychoactive. There's going to be no way for, a kid to go out there, get his hands on it and get high or anything. But what it is going to do is going to make it very hard for farmers to raise biomass while staying under that 0.3% THC standard. It's just genetically, it's a hard thing to do right now. So there are things like that I hope actually loosen up in the hemp industry as people get more comfortable and gain more understanding about what this plant actually is. And see it for something different than, marijuana and cannabis. Not that there's anything wrong with that or that industry, but they are differing products. And unfortunately, our industry gets a little bit of the stigma that comes along with cannabis as a whole. But, I think that's going to be something that here in the next couple of years is education and these, crops start to roll out in more states, that we're going to see some loosening of regulations, hopefully.
How is other states handling their hemp production compared to the state of Michigan?
So everything's kind of tentative right now, unless they were applying under the 2014 Farm Bill. That was a pretty set standard as far as the collection of data. Some states were more stringent on what they required as far as data collection, but it was all based on a research-driven proposal. So this year it's going to be kind of different to see how different states handle it. I can tell you right now what I know in comparison from Iowa to Michigan. Iowa's price structure is more. We're going to be paying more for our licenses. We're only allowed to grow 40 acres our first year. That's the most that any farmer can grow in Iowa, where here in Michigan, if you got a license, you could have put 1,000 acres if you were crazy and wanted to do it. Which are, there's a good and a bad side to that acreage restriction, but in Iowa, we follow stringent FDA standards. And since the FDA hasn't made a ruling on CBD oil, the product itself is illegal at this point in Iowa, which means that none of my farmers next year are going to be able to do anything with their hemp except dry it and then, you know, ship it over state lines to be processed. So there's a lot of variance, state to state, whereas here in Michigan, you know, obviously you've had the medical cannabis community for a while. So you have a bunch of processors that are allowing processing in the state. They're allowing processing on the farm if you want to do it. Michigan's taken a very good approach from what I've seen so far and how they've attempted to roll this out. And, you know, whereas we're seeing in comparison to Iowa, there's being a lot more stringent and going to put a lot more restrictions on farmers that are already dealing with, you know, mountains of restriction and hurdles to begin with, even entering this industry.
Hey, Matt, we've got a ton more questions about hemp for our hemp guru, Matt Hatala, but we have to take a break on the Tata Levelage show. So sit tight. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. Coming back strong with level 42. Something about you, Craig Russell. And that goes out to all my friends who in the 80s were into pop music. I was into the hair bands, into the English wave, a little bit of punk, and definitely, you know, southern rock. But I enjoyed some of those pop songs, and that one popped into my noggin this week, and thought I'd play it for the listeners because it's just an upbeat song. We got everybody out there in their deer blinds today.
That's right.
We have my good friend Matt Hatala on the mothership talking about everything hemp.
Can I tell you a little interesting fact about that Level 42 song and that group in general?
Sure.
Okay. They were much bigger in England than they were here. They had a couple of songs here. They had another song called Lessons in Love. But there's a guy in England who legally changed his name to everybody in the band and every song and every album that they had. Honest to God, his name is like 96 words long. It's every title of every song they ever had, every member of the band, and every album they ever had. He changed his name legally to that.
I'd like to change my name to Metallica because that's my all-time fave right there, Metallica. But hey, Craig, enough of us. We got Matt in the mothership.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Matt, I'm so happy to have you in studio in the mothership today. Can't thank you enough, Matt.
Absolutely. No, I appreciate you guys having me on.
Yep. Hey, so here's my question. Obviously, this show is heard all over the world as a podcast. You're very familiar with podcasting. Also, I also want to mention that Matt has been someone who is a public speaker. I know a number of conferences where he has spoken, and you're just so educational and informative and so knowledgeable in everything hemp. So my question is, for all those around the world, in the States here, especially in Michigan, and they're listening to this show, they want to become hemp farmers. How does one become a hemp farmer?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's so I'm just going to go with the assumption that whoever is wanting to get in this industry has an understanding for this plant. If you don't have an understanding for this plant, that's where you need to start. You need to understand the basics of what you're going to be growing, because it's not like corn and soy in a lot of regards, and it's not like traditional farming in a lot of regards. You need to do your research and find out exactly the work that it's going to take, because it's a lot more than people really anticipate. So I would start off with doing as much research as you possibly can, you know, learn the crop, learn what other people are doing, learn the pitfalls of the industry that other people are dealing with right now. And once you do your research, you know, if you decide, okay, this is something I definitely want to do, start from the end, reverse engineer it. You know, first off, where is your product going to go? You know, I think people who have traditionally farmed before don't understand the lack of infrastructure that is happening right now or going on in the industry, to where it's not just as easy, you know, even if you do everything right, which if this is your first year farming, it is, you know, few and far between chances that that's going to happen. But let's just say you do everything right and you grow the best product possible. That still doesn't mean that you're going to have somebody that's coming to beat down your door to buy that. So you need to figure out where your product is going to go and try and have those conversations with those people before you even put a seed in the ground. Now, I know some people along the way have been sold this this saying, you know, don't put a seed in the ground unless it's sold. And, you know, that's a great in theory, but I don't think you can name any industry where someone can come up and say, hey, you know, buyer, I've never grown this before. I've never done this before. Are you willing to, you know, give me a contract before I put a seed in the ground? Not likely. So the best thing that you can do is try and figure out, do market research, find out where your product's going to go. Call the people that could be potentially buying your product. Say,
how do you
hey,
find
you know,
those people? Like, where are they at? How do you find those people?
You got to get creative at this point. Honestly, that was one of the things that I did over this last season was I strategically found people within the industry that I felt could use our product. A lot of those people were out west just because Michigan has a huge bottleneck right now in processing. There's only about two or three people in the state that can process, and they're only at a couple thousand pounds a day. Well, when you're pulling an average of 2,000 pounds an acre, it's going to probably take about 50 years to get the state run done at that rate from 2019. So you've got to get really creative and not only figure out the outlets of where it could potentially go as far as buyers, processors, but then get in touch with them and try and figure out, you know, if you were looking at product on the market, how would you like that to be? You know, do you want it milled? Do you want it just bucked? Do you want it put in super sacks? Do you want it packaged? Get an idea of what the market is demanding that time for the product, you know, and start those relationships, you know, give them an idea of what you're doing. Nobody's in the beginning, nobody's going to care, you know, who you are or what you're doing, because there's about 50 million hemp farmers out there this year just getting started. And with so many people having ups and downs, you know, there it's not likely unless you've been growing this crop before and have a track record that you're going to be able to sell that crop prior to putting it in the ground. So that's a major risk right now for people getting started. But in doing that research, you're going to find out what the market is demanding and what those buyers that you're ultimately going to be targeting at the end of the year are going to be demanding. And that can help you form your, you know, your operating procedures, your farm plan. And then throughout the year, what you need to be doing is marketing yourself. You need to be taking pictures, collecting data, thinking it from the mindset of this buyer who doesn't know me, who I've never worked with, who's in a new industry, what would make them comfortable with buying my product at the end of the year? So COAs, certificates of analysis every week when it goes into flower, you know, data collection on what nutrients were used, you know, how much water were you giving it? You don't have to give them, you know, the keys to the house. You don't have to tell them every little secret that you do, but, you know, organic standards are a big deal in the industry right now. So making sure you're following those and recording the data and basically setting yourself up to have a crop that somebody wants to buy at the end of the year.
Okay. So let me just interject this. So
yeah,
you're someone out there listening to the show, listening to the podcast, listening to Matt Hatala. They don't have farmland, or they do have farmland, or they have the ability to lease farmland, or they have family and friends who have farmland. So obviously you have to grow it on some land. And again, I'm not a farmer. But as a mountain biker, I like to shred. I find it very difficult as I head north in the great state of Michigan to bike these single tracks that are, it's all sand up north. And in the middle of the state, the ground is great. And even further south, it's all clay, which is even better at DT Energy Trail. So I'm talking biking, but the land is a land. So is this something that farmers take into consideration? I mean, can they grow it in sand? Can they, you know, there's clay, there's good soil. I mean, obviously I'm not naive. You want to grow it in, you know, the proper soil. So if you're a farmer or you have the ability to obtain land, what's the best type of soil or ground to grow it on?
So you're going to want to make sure that you have a sufficient organic matter within the soil. And what that's going to do is allow for adequate infiltration, adequate exchange of nutrients within your soil. But if you're having more of a sandier soil or a soil with less organic matter, there are options for you. You know, drip and plastic comes into play there. So the guys out in Colorado, you know, Colorado isn't known for having great soil, but they've been growing industrial hemp longer than anybody. And, you know, so there's different ways to get around those conditions. But ultimately, yes, you're going to be wanting to look for good black dirt. You know, soil remediation is a big thing. Making sure that you're getting adequate nutrients into that soil for this hemp to grow all year round. So you need to do your research on what that's going to require. It's a lot like corn, but differs extremely in a couple ways too, as far as nutrient requirements. So, you know, picking something with adequate drainage as well. Hemp does not like to have wet feet. And if it does for an extended period of time, there's a good chance you're going to get some root rot, which can lead to other diseases and really start to affect your field if not taken care of. So adequate drainage is another big thing. And then location as well, as far as security goes. Security from prying eyes that might try and take a couple plants when they go into flower, or security from things like cross-pollination. You know, try and tuck these fields for CBD, you know, away, surrounded by some trees, or somewhere where they don't
other
have
crops. How about other crops, yeah, like corn, something that grows?
As far as planting it around it?
I mean, I'm just trying to say to hide the fields, you know, hide the crops. I just threw that out there. I'm not sure if people are doing that, but I just thought it was
an idea. Actually are. Actually, one of our farms this year, we hid the hemp field in the middle kind of some corn fields and then a tree line. Away from prying eyes. And then obviously the farmers that we were working with had control of those cornfields. So they made sure that it was kept with organic standards as well. So we weren't dealing with any overspray under the hemp. But yeah, that's another way that you can strategically use, you know, your operation, what you're already doing to secure your field and your operation a little bit more.
Now that's something because, you know, being from Iowa, of course, Iowa is a huge corn area. So let's say you are a traditional farmer and you're thinking, you know what, I'd like to get into this hemp thing. Is there if I've already got a farm, let's say I've already got a 10,000 acre farm that's got corn and it's got soybeans.
Acres.
I don't know. I don't know anything about farming. Maybe that's way too big. Is that too big, Todd? Is that a huge farm?
Ask Matt. I think
Matt, is that a huge farm, Matt?
That's a pretty big farm.
Okay. Maybe 5,000 acres, 1,000 acres.
Craig,
I don't know anything.
Can we just start off with 500 acres,
okay,
please?
I don't know anything about farming. This is why Matt's on the show. So let's say in Iowa, you've got a big farm and you used to grow soybeans and corn and radishes and turnips or anything else. Is there any kind of farm that lends itself to being repurposed as a hemp farm that's better than the others? Because like I said, you were saying Iowa and corn, that's, you know, there's more corn fields and more corn farms in Iowa than there is in any other state. Is that a good start for a hemp production or a hemp farm?
So yeah, there's actually a lot of research going into that right now about finding out what hemp follows behind really well. They're doing research in Pennsylvania right now at a place called the Rodale Institute, where they're using hemp as a rotational crop with corn and soy. And they're actually seeing substantial yield increase on the corn and soy that follows hemp than when they follow it, you know, either with a monocrop, soy behind soy, corn behind corn, or a corn-soy rotation. So right now, it's looking like hemp is going to be easily, I shouldn't say easily, but could be put in as another rotational crop with corn and soy. So it'll be able to be used in rotation for Iowa farmers as another tool in their belt. I don't really suggest anyone put all their eggs in the hemp basket. So it's good to be able to, you know, use this on your farm as a tertiary means of providing for your farm. And a lot of the equipment also can be modified to be used for industrial hemp. So for like planting, we found that sugar beet plates work really well with a lot of the planting equipment. If your planter has a plate set up, sugar beet plates work really well. If you're using a grain drill, the sorghum sedan setting on a grain drill seems to work really well as well. So there's a lot of ways that farmers who have the existing equipment, who have the existing knowledge with corn and soy, can transition into the hemp industry. There's just a bit of a learning curve. And I think as long as they take that into consideration and are a little humble when it comes to some of those things, and knowing that this is a new crop that, you know, you can't farm the same way as corn and soy, and you're probably going to need a little bit of help and understanding getting yourself going with that. A lot of these guys have the potential to be very successful. It's just melding these two worlds that have been separated for a long time.
Okay, when we come back from break, Matt, and listeners of the show, let's talk about how one goes about getting the seed to plant their crops, and we'll take it from that point forward. When we come back here on the Todd Levitt Law Show with our good friend, Craig calls him the guru, the hemp guru, Matt Hatala. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show, broadcasting and podcasting in a beautiful green nutrient field, a hemp field today, by the way, because our good friend Matt Hatala is in studio in the mothership with Craig and I. And Matt, again, I know we talked about this at the offset of the show. Appreciate your service. You are a U.S. Marine. Once a Marine, always a Marine, right, Matt?
That is correct. Yes, indeed. No, I appreciate you guys having me on. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, no doubt. Absolutely. So before I went to break last segment, Craig, we were talking with Matt, and I had a question. Where do they start, or anybody? How do you get the seeds?
And honestly, real quick, I just want to back up because I think there's a step that goes before that involve yourself in trying to find seed. How are you going to dry this product? What is your drying capabilities? There's a huge problem going on right now nationwide where we're seeing plants left in the field. People trying to sell plants, you know, wet, because they don't have the capabilities to either get them out of the field, get them dried, or store them. So once you figure out this is something you're going to do, you know, you kind of have a tentative area where you're going to do it at, figure out what your drying capability is. Again, reverse engineer this. If you only have, enough space to dry 3 acres, do 3 acres. If you only have enough space to dry 10 acres, do 10 acres. That's something I'm seeing that a lot of farmers didn't think about until the 2-yard line. And now they're really kicking themselves in the butts by the amount of product that's rotting in their fields, or that they, you know, just aren't going to have room to store at the end of the year.
Well, Matt, now,
stuff isn't moving fast.
Hey, Matt, now we're talking, if you're just Joe Blow off the street who says, I'm going to be a hemp farmer. Yeah, maybe they don't understand some of this stuff. But most of these people who are like maybe repurposing a cornfield, they're people who already are farmers to begin with. And they know this kind of this process, albeit not exactly the same as doing as hemp. But if you're a corn farmer, you have to know, all right, what am I going to do when this corn is at its peak and I'm ready to do whatever it is I do with corn, whether I pull it, I sell it, I take the, you know, they've got obviously corn silos and things like that. Wouldn't you think that if you were going to become a hemp farmer, that would be a kind of a logical next step? You're like, all right, after I grow it, what do I do with it then? That's got to be something you got to have kind of figured out before you even put a seed in the ground, wouldn't you think?
You would definitely think so. And this isn't me making fun of any farmers I think the farming industry has gotten used to being able to, you know, pull their corn, dry their corn, and then drive it to the ethanol plant, stay in line, get unloaded, and get a check. You know, they didn't understand that this CBD industry wasn't set up for the amount of acres that were going to be cultivated this year. So we're having huge bottleneck issues in the processing alone for people that did have, you know, deals set up or had places they were supposedly sent it to. And then you have this whole other group of people that I think were just kind of naive to what it really took to market this product on the back end. And they got to, you know, September 15th and went, yeah, well, I don't really know where my product's going yet. And then it's a mad dash on social media everywhere. Oh, I've got 50,000 pounds of biomass. Anybody who's interested, you should have started this about, you know, 4 or 5 months ago when you were first planning this. Because if you're just worried about where it's going to go now, you've already lost. And you're going to be probably sitting on that product until 2019. Well, and then by then it's going to be worth nothing.
Well, not to discourage anyone who wants to maybe get into hemp farming, but is it, you were saying there's like what, 3 people in the whole state of Michigan who are dryers? Maybe you should do that instead. Maybe more people should get into, or is that even tougher to do, to get into other part of it, the processing or the drying or any of that, or the marketing of it? Would that maybe be the more logical thing? Maybe there's too many people growing.
It's the processing that right now there's 3 processors in the state, I believe. You know, the max can do 2,000 to 5,000 pounds a day, somewhere in there. A normal acre will pull, you know, 2,000 pounds alone. So you can see where the problem lies. But there, you know, again, that's not something that you can just jump into either. Even if you've been into the THC processing side of it, there are subtle differences. But if you don't know how to do CBD processing, you're not going to be successful. So to think that a farmer or someone else who has no idea how to grow it can just jump to the point of extraction, you know, maybe if you've got a lot of money and you can go hire someone that knows what they're doing, but I would suggest, you know, seeing an opportunity and thinking that you can fill it just because there's a gap there, especially when it comes to processing.
Of course, now if you want to hire Matt, Matt's phone number is 319.
I do not dabble in the process. I can point you in the right direction of great people to talk to that know a world lot more than I do, but now that's something I definitely don't deal in.
What has to change, Matt, in Michigan and other places to get more processors on board? What has to change?
That's a tough one.
Who is doing the processing right now?
So there's a someone in Lansing, Cristillion, I believe is the name of the company. I believe they're doing processing on some level. There was rumored to be another one over by Battle Creek that was getting set up, but I don't know if they ever got online.
So are you saying that all these farmers in the state of Michigan allowed for all these licenses? I recall at one point, the state had farmers and non-farmers show up at the Capitol handing out licenses to start hemp farming under the 2014 mm-hmm. farm bills we talked about in the second segment. And now there's all this biomass, but the state failed to inform and educate people that, hey, you have to have it processed. And hey, guess what, folks? You're going to spend tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars, time and energy and efforts, and yet your crop's going to come to fruition. And then you're not going to have anything that it's not, there's nowhere for it to go to get processed, and there's no one to buy it. I mean, it just seems like the hemp industry's here. Let's all grow. And now people are stuck.
I don't know if the blame should necessarily be, and I'm not saying that you were blaming them, but I'm not sure if the state should be taking the brunt of the lack of education. In my opinion, it was the state's duty to give us the opportunity to grow it. It's not their duty to hold our hand when growing it.
I can appreciate that.
I do agree, though, to a certain extent. You know, there was a lack of direction. I think part of that was because of the shotgun start that we had this year. But I really don't think that people would listen. You know, in Iowa, and that's just my closest thing to compare it to, just because I deal a lot with the Iowa Department of Agriculture and some of their representatives. They're very much trying to not necessarily scare people, but let them know that this is not going to be, this is not going to save your farm. This is not going to be an end all be all. You're not, this is not the lottery ticket that you've been wanting it to be. And I think that's a good approach. I don't think it's necessarily their stance to educate everyone, but if there are pitfalls and there are things that need to be said to farmers based on their research and what they've seen traveling other states and developing the plan that it's going to roll out, then I think it is, you know, helpful to hear that from the Department of Ag. But farmers are being beaten up for a long time. And even if you're not a farmer, you know, you see those dollar signs and you hear that one or two success stories that really had a great year. And I don't know if people would listen anyways. There's a lot of hype around this industry right now, and for good reason. I mean, it's a great industry, but there's a lot of people also losing a lot. And I don't think people really see that when they want to join. They see the what could be on the good side.
Matt, in 20 seconds, tell us about seeds.
Try and find a reputable dealer that's been around for a couple of years, you know, has a name in the industry.
Where do you find them? Where do you find these dealers? Online?
So, again, yeah, online. A lot of them are online. You know, I don't have any that I can really plug individually right now, but there's different websites as well, like Raw Hemp Marketplace, where people will be selling seed. So it's just like marketing yourself. You've got to get out there, get creative, do some searching. There's not a lot of stuff set up for plug and play in the hemp industry right now. So you've got to be willing to get out there and get your hands dirty.
Well, boy, we've still got many, many other questions to ask about hemp. Our hemp guru, Matt Hatala, who will be on with us again, I'm sure. You can stick around. We're going to do a special podcast with more hemp questions. So if you're listening to the podcast of this, download the next special small podcast extra. And if you're listening to the radio show on 98.5 UPS, go to Apple iTunes, go to Google Play, go to iHeart.
Just type in Todd Levitt Podcast. Just put in my name, Levitt Podcast. Multiple platforms will show up. It's free, so yeah, check it out.
Yep.
But and Matt will definitely be back on the show. Matt, you'll come back on the radio down the road, will you?
Oh yeah, if you guys will have me, absolutely.
You're done. You're invited. Absolutely,
Todd.
We have to go. Show's over. Everybody out there hunting in their blinds, be safe. Have a good time. We're not here for a long time. We're here for a good time. Take us out with some Level 42. We'll see you on the podcast extra after the show, folks.
The Todd L. Levitt Law Show, brought to you by Chad Malleywell Drilling of Rosebush, Clark Modular Homes, your most experienced and trusted builder in Mount Pleasant, Clear Vision Windows, Siding, Roofing, and Attic Insulation of Midland, Mackinac Properties and Northern Michigan Vacation Rentals, buying, selling, and renting properties in the Straits of Mackinac region since 1998, Tim's Collision Plus in Roscommon, Harrison Power Sports, Central Michigan's fastest growing full-line Arctic Cat dealer, and Dr. Robert Townsend and Denali Healthcare for your alternative health care needs.
Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.